We want to welcome everyone. My name's Jenny Reynolds.
And I'm Louisa Ferrara-Gonzalez.
And we're so happy to be with you today. We know multiple people are joining right now, so we're going to let everyone join in before we get started. But we're in New York together today, and we're so happy to be together and so happy to be with you guys and talk to you about the feeding course and our journey of creating the feeding course for NANT.
Yes, it was a real big honor to prepare this for NANT and for you NANT members and just the general community. We know that there's, you know, a lot of really great education out there, but we felt that a really in-depth, a really, you know, beginning to end type of course to cover this bedside clinical feeding assessments was kind of a gap. And so we kind of, it was fun. It was a lot of work, but we hope you guys will look into the course. It is 14.5 hours of CEUs. And we're going to, you know, answer any questions that you have about the course, about its development, about its content. So please, as you have questions, you can go ahead and plug that right into the Q&A button on the bottom of your Zoom panel, and we will field all the questions that you have. And hopefully you'll leave here having no questions about this course and what it may be able to provide you and your unit.
So welcome to everyone, people who are continuing to pop on. We're so happy to have you. I'm Jenny, and this is Louisa, and we're here in New York together, and we're excited to be together to talk to you about our NANT course. So the name of our course is Clinical Bedside Feeding Assessments in the NICU. And Louisa and I wanted to kind of just walk through the journey of how we created it, what the content is, and then we want you to throw out any question about the course. If you're interested in purchasing the course, put them in the Q&A. So Louisa, yeah. You want to get started and just talk about
how we
wanted to build this?
Some things I feel like Jenny and I were really proud to incorporate into the course for your benefit was a lot of evidence. We made sure that almost every slide there was a citation so that if there was information that you weren't familiar with or information where you felt like you wanted to get more in depth, there are references for you, a really in-depth reference list at the end of each module for you to go ahead and really get that evidence to support your practice in addition to the things that we were talking about. The other thing that I think was like the most fun was, I mean, obviously there was a lot of information a lot of strategies, a lot of evidence-based practice, but Jenny and I brought so many of our own experiences to all of that information to make it a lot more translatable for you and able for you to say, oh my gosh, that reminds me of this baby that I worked with. And so that you can pull that information into your clinical care. And there were so many videos and so many experiences. We were like, oh, I had this one kid once and this is what happened. And so where we do believe that the courses and the modules are just chock full of information that will absolutely help you. I believe that it comes across a little bit more conversational. Yeah. So I don't think it's as lecture-y because we kind of like made it fun and threw in a lot of those experiences that we've had.
Yeah. And I think, you know, when you attend, like, when we attend CEUs and when you are attending CEUs, one of the main, the feedback that both of us get is everybody wants more videos. Everybody wants to see clinical case studies. So we have tried to take many cases from Louisa's NICU, from my NICU, and plug that in to make it come to life because there's a lot of meat. There's a lot of some of our slides are dense with information. And like Louisa said, evidence-based info. And we tried to incorporate what's happening from researchers in all over our field. We wanted to honor their work and put their work into the clinical feeding assessment, but also then have those case videos and images and really help that with teaching. So Louisa, do we want to take a few of the questions? Go ahead and get started.
Okay. That's great. Absolutely. All right. So first question up, we have a question about, is this course more introductory in nature or more advanced? Jenny and I worked really hard to make sure that it was comprehensive enough as a foundation for a new introductory clinician in the NICU, but that there was also higher level information that, so if you have been in the NICU for years or a more advanced clinician, you can still pull a lot of benefits, again, as a review for those foundations, but on top of that as well. So we don't necessarily feel like it has just that introductory stamp on it.
Yeah.
You want to take the second question?
Sure. So it says, hi, Louisa and Jenny. I'm an OT in a level 4 NICU in DC. Thank you for doing this. I wanted to hear your thoughts on any updated info you have on feeding on respiratory support, high flow nasal cannula, CPAP, or feeding with trachs and vents, and trach cuff inflated or partially deflated. Thank you. Louisa, I'm going to turn this question right over to you because we are honored to have Louisa here today, who has done work in this area.
Well, thank you. And it's a great question. So yes. I will say that in our course, module 2, we have like a full hour, a little bit more than an hour, all about understanding pulmonary development in utero, mm-hmm. as well as postnatal lung growth and the importance of surfactant and the importance of respiratory supports. And we do absolutely talk about in our course how that interplays with the neurological processes for sucking, swallowing, and breathing. The update on the research, we had really completed all of the slides and modules the end of last year. So if there was a publication that came mm-hmm. out after December of 2022, it did not make it into mm-hmm. the modules. And obviously we can't be on top of all of the research after we kind of finalized that. But as of right now, I don't believe there's any further publications mm-hmm. on the topic. Yeah. I know my unit is still undergoing some clinical trials on that, as well as there's a really nice unit in Germany that is as well. So definitely stay tuned on that updated. But in the course itself, again, if it wasn't out before December of 2022, it didn't make it into the modules.
Yeah. Thanks, Louisa. So one of our next questions is about, is the course directed to feeding skills training for all levels of NICU, level 2 to level 4? I would say absolutely. Like, we really didn't look at it. We created it for anyone working in the NICU and anyone performing clinical feeding assessments in the NICU. We highlight instrumental swallowing, but we really, with 14.5 CEs of time, we were truly trying to focus on the clinical feeding assessment and the whole infant, that we know that all of the domains, neurobehavioral, neuromotor, sensory, family, environment, we felt like we had to talk and discuss all of those areas to really then talk about assessing feeding and swallowing. And yeah. So we hope this is a comprehensive picture for PT, OT, speech, any neonatal yeah. therapist, yeah. Wanting more information about assessing yeah. feeding and swallowing.
And you know, I think about, especially like a level 2 NICU, a lot of those babies maybe aren't getting a lot of assistance in general. Maybe there isn't even a lot of neonatal therapists present in the level 2 NICUs. Mm-hmm. But I do feel like the way that the information was presented will absolutely be beneficial to any of the level NICUs. You know, obviously it was directed towards neonatal therapists, but like, I wish that like, at least some of those snippets, like even neonatal nurses could get, because yeah. it's very heavy in cue-based feeding. It's very heavy in that whole infant and looking at the environment and how the parents play in that, you know, parent-infant dyad and Allison active theory and like all of these things that just really make the NICU environment a very unique place to work. And these babies are getting fed 8 times a day. So, you know, we want to make sure that every single feeding opportunity for these kids mm-hmm. are appropriate and are well supported by every person who puts their hands on those babies. But for regardless of levels, I think it would suit any level.
Absolutely.
Yeah. There's a question here about, does the course discuss, other scales appropriate for neonatal populations, like the BROS, the NOMAS, the OFS, oral feeding scales. And yes, in module 4, we have several slides that go through and list all of those, the various types of assessment mm-hmm. tools and scales and validated assessments that are available. Each of them come with the publication, the reference, and also like a little snippet about what they are about, but we don't go into full explanation of how to use each tool. It was really used to kind of set up as a launching pad. So mm-hmm. if you felt like, ooh, one of that tool sounds like a really good fit, or ooh, I like this tool because it incorporates autonomic stability, or ooh, I like that tool because it incorporates a parent assessment in there. So you can kind of see which fit is best for you. But I think on that module 4, I think we have like 3 slides of like mm-hmm. 4 on yep. each. So there's quite a list. And then while some of them are repeated, we have a similar list of all of the assessment tools for breastfeeding as well. That's in module 5.
Yeah.
So module 5 is all about breastfeeding mm-hmm. for the neonatal therapist. And it goes through the anatomy and physiology of breast and lactation and how to help assist an infant latch and the mechanisms for all of that. And again, dense with a lot of videos so that you guys can really learn with or without, you know, stepping so far out of your scope if you don't have an LC or an IBCLC certification, but enough for you to really show up to the bedside educated and assist in that process, especially for those babies.
Yeah. And we talk about too the importance of partnership with lactation and how we can partner with lactation as neonatal therapists. So yeah, I love that. There is a great question about asking if we go beyond the NICU for those that are working with NICU grads in EI. And what I would tell you is I actually just spoke with someone who is taking the course currently. I was telling Louisa, and she's in my PhD program with me, and she came from EI and is now brand new in the NICU. And she was telling me that she feels like this course, she really wished that she had this course before going into EI, because she's like, we have these medically complex kiddos coming from the NICU into EI. And I think this is absolutely, I mean, Louisa, I want to hear your thoughts, but I think this is, like you said, a launching pad, but also foundational knowledge on how to go in and do a comprehensive feeding and swallowing assessment.
Yeah.
And I think it would be great for EI clinicians.
Yeah.
And
clinicians. I think where a lot of the literature is specific to the NICU population mm-hmm. and preterm or medically fragile population, the actual strategies of, you know, looking at the whole infant mm-hmm. and like that doesn't really differ mm-hmm. from unit to unit or environment to environment. So absolutely, if you're an EI therapist and you're getting a lot of these NICU grads, or if you're running a post-discharge neonatal developmental clinic, there, I think there'll be very, very great value in this course for your understanding of that. And as well as, I mean, we integrate and weave through all of the material the importance of parent training and involving the parents and supporting them and their goals and making sure that we're not just treating the infant, but we're treating the family as a whole. And that's all NICU grad, mm-hmm. very, very relevant. So absolutely a value for you.
Yep. We have another question that is asking if we provide a scale to communicate our findings. I think like Louisa already said, we do address different standardized feeding scales that would be a way to communicate findings, but we also provide a lot of examples of after finding scoring this for readiness or for quality and talking about how to communicate with the multidisciplinary team or the interprofessional team about feeding and how important the entire interprofessional team is in making those decisions about feeding. I think we do address that throughout the course.
There's also a lot of videos where, like in one of the modules, like we're talking all about Allison synactive theory. And so, you know, we're giving you the foundation and explaining to you like, okay, if you're looking at the autonomic subsystem, these are some of the things that you would look for. And then we're providing then a video and we're assessing it together. And so the terminology that we use and the way that we're describing what the infant is doing would be a nice way to kind of set up the language that you would write in your notes. But in terms of actual reporting, again, there are so many really useful scales that look at feeding as well as stability cues and stress cues that are all integrated into certain scales. So there are several that have, you know, all of those aspects, and that's all listed and provided in, I believe, module four.
Mm-hmm. There's a question about if we address pre-feeding in this course. And I would say what we do is we start more global, looking at trauma-informed care, family-centered care. And I would say we kind of briefly touch on it, but we really dive into when are they appropriate to begin the bedside, since the title of the course is more looking at the clinical bedside feeding eval, we really kind of dive into that. How would you
explain? Yeah, well, pre-feeding in terms of is more of like an intervention, right? So this module is all about assessment.
Yeah.
The only time we really touch on intervention is where we talk about the importance of, in your assessment, trying something so that the assessment isn't like, oh yeah, they're not very good at their model. It's, well, they're not very good at that, but here's what we could do to help. So that topic of oral motor stimulation and non-nutritive sucking stimulation, that again, that falls under intervention, and that isn't part of this module, but it is brushed upon as a nice way to integrate it into an assessment, as well as assessing non-nutritive sucking skills, assessing oral reflexes, assessing infant readiness from an oral musculature standpoint. So, so more from an assessment lens and not from an intervention lens.
Yeah. There's another question about, what bottles we talk about during the assessment. And I mean, during the course in the assessment and asking about disposable bottles, we will discuss the literature about disposable nipples, about flow rate, about managing flow rate, about discussing flow rates with the interprofessional team, about communication on the interprofessional team with flow rates as part of our assessment. And providing recommendations. So we absolutely do address them.
And I think in our videos, there's a good representation of, you know, perhaps videos where the babies are on a Dr. Brown's system versus on a Enfamil system or a Abbott system, like a take and toss from like the hospitals, right? So we do try to be like representative for however that might, you know, resonate to your unit and allow some symmetry there.
Yeah.
These questions are really great, guys.
They're very
good. I'm like so excited that there's so many questions in here. So thank you. Keep them coming.
Yeah.
I like this top one.
Okay, do it.
Okay, someone wrote, hello. I took your class and it was great. Thank you. We're so glad that you liked it. A question I have regarding feeding and tachypnea. How do you handle a baby who is chronically tachypnic, such as a cardiac baby whose tachypnic may not resolve with maturity? So I think this is a really great question because, you know, we have sometimes this information, like you're not supposed to feed a baby if they're breeding over 60 BPMs, right? Like, and like that to me sounds like a hard stop, but we clinically always have to find that like risk to benefit ratio. So we need to make sure that we're giving that baby an opportunity to learn and to experience not only oral movements, but taste and smell development and all of these other really valuable things that they get during a feeding with the safety, right? We know that if a baby is breathing, if they're really tachypnic, if they're really having a hard time, if they have an increased work of breathing, that is going to significantly affect the suck, swallow, breathe coordination and lead to potentially some airway misdirection. So we have to find that sweet spot, and there's not going to be a black and white statement for every baby. That's where we look at this whole child approach. This is why literally the first two whole modules of the course is just understanding the communication between you and that infant so that you can try something and see where does that risk benefit ratio goes. Maybe this isn't a baby that we're going to be feeding 8 times a day, full PO feeds, but maybe there's a way for us to get them to feed five cc's over 5 minutes before that tachypnea gets maybe higher or worse, or the work of breathing gets worse. And also we're not seeing significant stress cues and we're not seeing any overt signs of aspiration, right? Like, so there's a little bit of a juggle there. And I do feel like between some of the videos that we've shown, there's a nice way to kind of use your clinical judgment to find a way to hit all of our goals of a feeding. So we know like there's five main goals, right? It needs to be safe, right? It needs to be nurturing. It needs to be individually and developmentally appropriate. It needs to be functional, right? So yeah, obviously there's going to be that balance. But if just because a baby is a cardiac kiddo and constantly tachypneic, it doesn't mean that that kid is strictly an NPO and there's nothing we could do. Sorry. Like, I feel like we work hard to try to find something to help with the development, even if it may not be full PO.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Great question.
Good question. So another question, which I think we did answer this just a second ago, but I want to make sure I touch it, is about bottle selection. We will, like I said, just to review, we'll go through the literature behind nipple flow rate and in determining appropriate flow rate for an infant. We'll talk about a vented bottle system versus a non-vented bottle system. So we will include that. It is included in there.
We highlight a lot of Caitlin McGrattan and Rick Pados's work for those topics.
Absolutely. Another question about that she's in a level three unit and wondering if this course is only focused on assessment used for feeding, or is treatment techniques included? It's hard to talk about assessment without talking about treatment. So we are going to talk about how do you use those treatment strategies? What's the evidence behind the strategies we have, the feeding support strategies we have that we're utilizing in our assessment to then communicate recommendations? So we do address that, but we're not taking a deep dive into treatment.
No, I would definitely say that this is definitely more assessment based, but like I said, you know, we don't just do an assessment and say, yep, you're right, it's not working for this baby. We always want to be able to provide something in our assessment as a recommendation. So, so we do brush on that for sure. These questions are so good. It's hard to pick just one. So there's a question here about how much skill is normal or appropriate for particular postmenstrual ages. So we do go in a review for anatomy and physiology. We touch upon embryology. We touch upon what we would expect in a preterm for certain ages in terms of all of their systems. So for autonomic motoric state, as well as pulmonary. So, and like oral motor. So all of that from a postmenstrual age would be there. And I believe that's in module two. Mm-hmm. Yes.
There are some questions about, I see a couple of questions about, interprofessional rounds and if we address the feeding therapist on the interdisciplinary team. I was going to say in module one, we talk about teaming, feeding teams, and how in every NICU across the country, across the world, you're going to see feeding teams look different. And the terminology feeding therapist may look different in each NICU. And we talk about that. And we talk about how do you do that with multiple, maybe you're solo in the NICU and you are the feeding therapist, or maybe you have multi disciplines on your neonatal therapy team. And how does that work? And then also functioning within the interdisciplinary team. So we do talk about that in the first module.
And I think I love that we come from very different backgrounds. Yes. Like you're in Texas, I'm in New York, but like you come from like a really great interdisciplinary team. Like on her team, she has OTs and PTs and SLPs, and they all like work in this like beautiful symmetry and you share babies. Mm-hmm. Like it's, and in my unit, it's not like that at all. So like we share our experiences and we share, mm-hmm. you know, what we found to work and not work. So I think that module one is kind of unique to what we've done. Mm-hmm. Cause if you think about feeding assessments and like a lot of people just jump right to the anatomy and physiology and right to like the technical stuff. But I love that we started off with the environment, mm-hmm. and the NICU and the teams and that whole infant approach. Cause I feel like without that as that foundation, you lose so much. Mm-hmm. You lose so much of what matters to the infant. So definitely module one, interdisciplinary practice and teamwork. And not only is that in module one, but it's also really heavy on that mom and the dad, and looking at their goals and asking them, what are your goals?
Yep.
How can we help you achieve your goals? Mm-hmm. As part of the assessment, thinking about them as a team member, right? Not just someone I'm going to report to afterwards, but they were really taking them into the team as well.
And the importance of communication, because that we hit on that, because I think, you know, seeing that there's multiple questions about this, I know that this comes up. It's like, how do we know feeding overlaps so many different, every discipline of the interdisciplinary team, and how do we work together to have a unified message to the family, about the baby. And we also talk about in my unit, we recently did a multidisciplinary feeding work group. And so we I talk about that a little bit and how that was a really positive experience of getting everyone back to the table, putting the baby in the middle, the baby and the family in the middle, and figuring out how are we going to look at evidence-based practice, best practices for feeding together as an interprofessional team. But we hit that in module one. So that's a good question.
Yeah. There's a question here about using the mini Haberman with all babies. That seems like something that's happening a little bit in some of their babies. So when we talk about nipple selection and flow rates, as well as like a compression-based bottle system, which is what the Habermans are, that is something that we do talk about in the evidence supporting that. And we relate it back to normal oral motor development and why some babies might need a compression-based bottle system, mm-hmm. and some babies will not. And if they don't need it from like an actual functional standpoint, it can affect the way they learn how to create suction. And then that could lead to some difficulties down the road. So we absolutely do touch on that topic. Do we discuss laryngomalacia? Yeah.
Yeah.
And we talk a lot about Nikki Mills' research. She's mm-hmm. out of New Zealand. She's an ENT. So we talk about that at the end of module two.
I think so.
Yeah. Then module two, that's in our anatomy and physiology module. So we go through laryngomalacia, and there's actually a really great study about how different positions help safety for that. So that answer is there for sure.
There's a great question about that this person has taken Sophie with Dr. Aaron Ross, who's amazing, an amazing program, and how she integrates all synactive theory in a lot of her course, and how does this course differ? Well, I think that's one approach, and we do spend a bit of time in module three on all synactive theory, but we also are trying to look at many different approaches to looking at assessments to looking at feeding.
Yeah. But I think that field right now.
Sorry. I've got some water.
I think that's what's so cool about our field right now is that like we have so many amazing and fantastic researchers. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the theories are so similar, mm-hmm. right? Like, yes, there's a clear difference between Sophie and the early feeding skills scale and the infant driven feeding scale. But they all integrate that's very similar ideas, right? A little different take, a little different evidence behind them, a little different you know, perspective, but all of that is there. And so because we were learning from these geniuses like Dr. Ross and Dr. Thoyer, and there's so many amazing clinical researchers that are providing us with such amazing tools, and they all have similar underpinnings. And I think that our course highlights all of them and pulls in a lot of that for the understanding for the bedside. So even if your unit says, no, we don't want a standardized tool, we're not going to pay for you to get training for a standardized tool, you can take this course and still pull the goodness from those other tools to be really efficient and really helpful to those babies that you're treating or assessing, rather.
And that's what we were hoping to integrate, you know, really integrate everything that we've learned from all of these amazing researchers across our field, and then also integrate our own, as Louisa said, our own clinical experiences with that foundational knowledge
And where the Sophie might have been like a perfect fit for your unit, maybe it won't be a perfect fit for the other one. Maybe they need instead, you know, Dr. Pineda's scale or maybe Dr. Pato's scale. Like there's so many. So the slides that we have on standardized assessment tools, or just assessment tools in general, we'll kind of parse out to you which one might be a better fit for you. And then you can go forward from there. Also, I think if you're a NANT member, a couple of years ago, a NANT conference, I think two OTs did a really great lecture at NANT on like all the different assessment scales. So we actually used a lot, we referenced them. That presentation was really, really helpful. So there's a lot of questions about assessment scales. That might be a nice resource for you to go back into the NANT hub and go and watch just like a, you know, just on that one topic.
We had another question about how we discuss feeding within the multidisciplinary team. And I think I can just talk to in our unit. I'll go ahead and give a quick little synopsis. We brought everyone to the table. We brought nursing, physicians, therapists, lactation, our nurse manager, our medical director, everybody came to the table. And we said, we want to look at evidence-based practice with feeding. Right now we have a work group looking at multidisciplinary rounds and how we do rounds and ensuring that we have the family as a part of the rounds. We also have a specific feeding rounds. And then we created something similar to Dr. Dodrell's work out of Brigham Women's, where they did a high risk, low risk scale for feeding. And we looked at that, created, updated all of our feeding policies, but we did it with everyone at the table, which really allows for buy-in, because we know that it can be challenging sometimes communicating on that interdisciplinary team and being on the same page. But I think if you come to discuss what is the evidence, and that was the most exciting part. It was hard, but it was exciting to hear, like, we had nurses at the table that were like, I didn't know this. This was new information for me. These articles that are coming out, they're like, wow, this is what you learned at your NANT conference? Oh, okay, cool. Like, you know, again, so bringing all that information to the table, sharing it with one another, and then together creating how do we want feeding to be communicated. But the most important part, having the parents hear a unified message. And that was our goal. We want our parents to hear a unified message, because if they're hearing a different thing from the therapy team, the nursing team, the physician, you know, the provider. So we try to put some systems in place like rounds, and specifically we have a dysphagia rounds, a feeding rounds, where we're bringing everyone together so that we can get on the same page when we're communicating with the family.
It's so unique that what you did, what your unit did.
Yeah.
That's really special. And I think that while every unit should have that, right? I think it's hard, right? Because like some of you are just maybe only getting a couple days in the NICU, right? And you want more. And like, there's not enough time for you to do everything that you need to do in your day, and then also be a leader to create something like that. Mm-hmm. And I will say, there's this feeling, I think there's this feeling in the course of empowerment. Like, first you have to know how it could look. Like, you even just sharing that example, like, did you know you could do that? Like, now that you know, and then in the course, we talk about like some of the key things to involve the parents, the key things to really thrive at interprofessional practice. And then you can take that and make it work for your NICU, for your team, because every NICU culture and every unit is so unique because there's no other you and there's no other of your coworkers. And like, you all bring something so individual and unique to the unit. But I think by looking at seeing what would be best, and then you can think outside of the box to see how you can integrate that into your unit. I think, again, both factors, the interprofessional piece, making sure that you are communicating in a respectful and a mutually beneficial way for the benefit of the baby and the family mm-hmm. to every member of your team, mm-hmm. whether they agree with you or not. But the fact that you can have that conversation, I think mm-hmm. that is pivotal for the care we provide, mm-hmm. But then also that parent participation piece. And that is very strongly woven through all of those modules. Yeah. We can't serve our babies if we're not involving those families.
Yeah.
So,
and we try to highlight that throughout the course and how to do that. Cause it can also be challenging when, if you have parents that are coming in at night and they can't come in during the day. So we try to talk about, some strategies and some examples for that. There's a great question about, it's a question about allowing, working toward we are working towards the first oral feeding being at the breast. And if the mom is willing, in a level four NICU, and is there research in this course regarding the benefits of that? So I will say our last module, module five, is about breastfeeding. And we talk about, in my particular unit, we have an option for the mothers if they want to have a protected window of breastfeeding. I would say that the number was kind of just selected out of the air. I mean, we say 2 weeks. But in certain units, it may be 1 week. It may be, you know, I mean, every unit that I have talked to, it's a little different. But we talk about the benefits of having that. I don't know of specific research.
There's one study, okay. But it looks at the 72-hour window.
Okay.
72 hours.
Okay. So we do talk about that in module five. Yeah. Great question.
There's just a repeat question. Someone wanted us to repeat the five goals of feeding. Mm-hmm. So this comes right out of Ludwig and Ludwig's their original infant-driven feeding mm-hmm. publication. So there's five goals of feeding. Needs to be safe. Needs to be functional. So safe is like not only safe against obviously airway compromise, but we would consider it also safe against undue stress. Mm-hmm. It needs to be functional, which means that we want them to benefit from the calories they're eating and not burn so many calories eating that it becomes a moot point. We want it to be nurturing, right? So a lot of bonding, a lot of pleasurable experiences between the infant and family dyad. It needs to be developmentally appropriate. So I don't care if it's a big, chunky, 38-weeker IDM baby, we're going to take him where he is developmentally and then individually minute to minute, right? So like, I don't care if he was able to eat all of his bottles yesterday, I'm looking at him right now and he can't. So how are we going to support what he's showing up individually as himself today? So again, safe, functional, nurturing, developmentally appropriate, and individualized. So those are the five goals.
There is another question about special populations. Two things. One is about special populations with craniofacial patients. We do hit a little bit on special populations, but not a lot, just because we just didn't have enough time. We could have done several more lectures to hit that, but we do talk about tethered oral tissue and about the evidence that is out there about that. And then, just lightly brush over that. So.
Yeah.
Good question.
Oh, this is a nice question. Do you have any suggestions or review any methods for communication among the therapy team, especially for clinicians that may not be working on the same day? This is a great question because, like, you know, sometimes you come into work and you have like 30 kids to see and you don't have time to always look at all of the notes prior mm-hmm. to you showing up. And this is why sometimes being a participant in rounds, is so nice mm-hmm. because, you know, you kind of do get to hear all of that, but even that, not a lot of therapists get to have dedicated time on rounds. So this is, again, one of those opportunities to look and think about, you know, how every unit is different and, you know, the method that might work really well in my unit maybe won't work at all in yours. So I think the way that you would start a conversation about this is to get your team to the table and say, hey, we're not having great follow through day to day. What are our ideas? How can we make that communication between us on the care of this baby and that baby and that baby and that baby more consistent? And in your unit, it might be, that you print the notes. I don't know. It might be that you maybe do things on a little card, or maybe you message them just the recommendations. If you have like an EMR, like instead of sending over the whole note, just send over just your recommendation. So they have to read one line on each baby. So there's, again, a lot of different strategies that, again, may work great in my unit and may not work great in your unit. But I think the key of it is having a discussion, getting those stakeholders to the table and say, what do you think? How can we do this together? Let's try it. And if it doesn't work, let's try something else. Yeah. But just to say we have bad communication, this is never going to be solvable, isn't right. Right. So.
Yeah, some strategies that we've tried, because we've tried multiple different things. We have a lot of PRNs coming in, and for them to be efficient and jump in. One thing I do think that for those of you who use Epic, we have been able to add one of those follow-up rows where we can just put the plan of care and what the next intervention, like what we're doing, what respiratory support they're on, what we're doing if they're feeding, like if they're breastfeeding or if they're bottle feeding, like what the feeding plan is. We try to put that in that little, so that they know one row they can look at of what we're actively working on, or if they need parent education because they're about to discharge, whatever that is. But then also Epic Chat has made a whole new, opened up a whole new ballgame, because you can just write a quick note to the PRN working tomorrow. And here's just a couple of quick handoff notes for them. So it's nice. The EMR does make it nice.
I never thought about the follow-up job. That's right. Because then you can even put that, if you have Epic, the follow-up, you could actually put that into your home screen tab. So like with patient name and unit and bed.
Yes.
You could put. And that's so literally just look at your census, you can have that as one of your columns.
Yep.
I like that idea.
Yeah. So that's something that we just, did. So,
yes. Okay. Let's see.
There's another question, Louisa, about
this one.
Your research. Yeah.
There's a question. So will I be further discussing your research with feeding babies on CPAP? I've attended your presentations on NAN and at St. Louis and would love to hear any updates. Thank you. All right. So I got to tell you, the pandemic really kind of screwed up my research, and the NIH wasn't as generous with my topic, given everything else that was going on with the pandemic. That, and we did attempt to do some of that study on our own, but it was really hard to get parent participants at the time, because with the pandemic, it was really, really tough. So we are back in the wheels. We are in the middle of writing another big NIH grant, not to look at the CPAP now, but to look at the high flow nasal cannula. I feel like we've all kind of like said, okay, CPAP might be, you know, too aggressive, but we have a lot of people in the medical field that are still feeding on pretty high flow rates of high flow nasal cannula. And what we found, and what the literature also supports, is that flow rates above 2 liters per minute have very similar distending pressures as CPAP. So that was one of the main difficulties for these babies under fluoroscopy in my published study for CPAP, was that at the time of a swallow, you want everything to close, right? But the CPAP, the continuous positive airway pressure, was stenting everything open, and it was causing very unsafe swallowing environment for that liquid passage. So while we know CPAP, these babies were on a PEEP of 5, again, very strong distending pressures. People are like, oh, well, high flow nasal cannula can't be that strong, right? It's a different latch, and then it's a different device in the nose, a different cannula, it's different pressures. The research shows that distending pressures are similar on high flow nasal cannula to CPAP if the flow rate is over 2 liters per minute. And so ideally we want to wait for a baby to be less than 2 liters per minute. I have some anecdotal data that is not yet ready to be published saying that like 1.5 liters may actually be like the sweet spot. But I do believe that it will, and we know the research supports that that varies very, very much between babies in terms of their weight, in terms of their head position, their mouth position, and the seal of the cannula in their nose. So there was one study by Liao in 2021, really well done study, many charts looking at different high flow nasal cannular flow rates, different gestational age groups, different weights, and then different mouth positions and head positions. And so it was like a really well done way. But this is like my concern with high flow nasal cannula and infants is that at any given time as a therapist, you coming up to the unit and to a bedside to feed a baby on these devices, am I expecting you to always have those charts in your back pocket and like taking the real time to look at, okay, well, exactly how much distending pressure is this baby going to have? And is this baby going to know this distending pressure? You can't always know all of that. So we're leaning in that like risk benefit ratio where we want them to have positive learning experiences, but we have to make sure that we're not giving them an unsafe learning environment either. So I like to really fall back on those instrumental swallowing assessments for babies that you're saying, well, they're so old and they are so hungry and they're showing all of these hunger cues and they're really, really interested in eating. And how can I support them in that? So I am a big believer is you try small trials, and if they look like they're tolerating that, you then bring them to an instrumental assessment, whether that's a feast through the fibroscope in the nose or a fluoroscopy, and you see if it's true. You see if that approach is individualized and proven to be safe for that baby. But without us seeing inside, we don't know. And we can't just make that those assumptions sometimes. And especially, hopefully we're discharging these babies. And can we trust the parents to know that? Because the baby is going to constantly gain more weight. The baby's going to always have a different maybe respiratory status. And so I always like to fall back on instrumental assessments for those kiddos. But in the meantime, I do promise to continue my research endeavors to get more updated information. It's very, very slow going. So I apologize. But thank you for your kind words about my research. Hopefully.
But we're so thankful to have what we have and know that there's more. Yeah, exactly. That there's more coming. And I think too, like, I'm sure y'all see this too, the face of these NICU babies are changing. Like they're more and more complex and there's more and more small babies, very low birth weight, extremely low birth weight. And then I think, I don't know if it, maybe this is just my unit or if this is also what you're seeing is like, as they progress and get closer to 40 weeks, these parents are going crazy and they want their babies out of the hospital. Maybe they're still on 2 liters. They've just started, you know, they got off CPAP late in the game, then 4 liters, 3 liters, 2 liters. And then what we find is our physicians will want to just turn it down to be like, okay, we're going to turn them to 1. And then they're so tachypneic. They can't even just at rest, they can't breathe. So how do we expect them to eat? And so then it's like, we have to have a lot of conversations still with the providers about, hey, if you're going to try to turn this down, we can't expect an increase in PO. Like we've got to let them have positive, pleasurable. We as neonatal therapists have to be advocating for those positive, pleasurable feeding experiences. And I do think that's when we can get the parents as the baby's best advocate to say, hey, this doesn't look safe for my baby. My baby looks uncomfortable. They're breathing so fast. I want to just do passy dips. I mean, really taking it way back and saying, I'm not going to push.
But that only works if the messaging is the right messaging from day one.
Correct. That's true.
Right. Like if they only know that, like, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Like your baby's going to overcome like crazy medical miracles.
Yes.
And then all they have to do is finish their bottle and then they can go home. Exactly. Right. Like that messaging will not work for us. Yes. Right. That messaging we know is not a good, not a good way to support these babies or the families, because by the time they're finally weaning off that respite, they get like that NICU-itis. We're like, they want out. They want out. They want to get out of here. So you have to just make sure your messaging is really, really like honest. Like this is going to be a process. You know, your baby was born preterm, surfactant was low, all this lung development in, you know, this very non-supportive NICU environment compared to the uterus, right? And compared to the womb. So again, knowledge is power. The more information and education you can provide those families, the better. But I think then as you're starting to wean off those respiratory supports, there's actually, it came out in 2022, there was a research study showing that the sensory receptors of the pharyngeal mucosa is needs a period of rest after after respiratory support in order for it to like regain like or like habilitate back to its like functioning.
Wow.
Because remember, those sensory receptors have like habituated to that positive pressure, that constant airflow. And so there's the anecdotal like recommendation is that if you're going to try PO, you should wait at least 12 to 24 makes hours sense. So that the sensory system, those sensory receptors have some time to re-regulate before now you're reintroducing flow.
Yeah. And we talk about that feeding really begins on day of life one, like, and really walking through beginning to educate that family. If you can, if you have orders to be able to start that education early, so that then by the time they're at the place where they're appropriate for oral feeding, you've already built this beautiful foundation. So very, very good question.
Oh, there's a question here about what do you say to bring a baby to fluoro who's on high flow nasal cannulas? Oh. Our RTs say it cannot be done. So we do it in my unit all the time. Yours
too. You do too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. They get transported with the canister. And then when they get into the fluoro suite, they go to the wall.
And in some, I mean, it depends on the unit, but in some units, the respiratory therapist and the nurse come down to radiology. And then in some units, it's just the nurse, but they have all of the, and then they ensure that we have suction set up and all of it while we're down in radiology if needed.
Oh, this is a great question. Have you ever offered a parent class that would be like pre-teaching or for feeding, explaining development expectations, five goals of feeding, signs of stress, behavioral, autonomic, et cetera. I would love to do that in our unit, but I'm having trouble getting buy-in from the unit. Okay. I love this question. So yes, I have created, when I was clinical now several years back, cause I'm more research now, but, a 1 hour parent class, similar, like, you know, they have like these breastfeeding support classes and education classes once a week for the parents, not only in the NICU, but also on the maternal baby floor. And so I decided to do the same thing. I did it like on like a Wednesday at 4 o'clock. So the goal was I would reach some of the day parents that came in, they would stay later. And then I would catch maybe some of the, like the working parents that would maybe like leave work early and come for that class. And for me, it was purely for parent education. Again, knowledge is key for these families. And it was really exciting. I like rolled up towels and everyone got to like pretend with the baby. And it was the same information every week. And then it ended up being a really nice area of support. I had some parents come for like, they had like 28 beakers and they just wanted to know. They were just eager for the information. And it ended up being a really nice resource for the families. But what I didn't know, and that surprised me, and I was so, so, so happy about it, was that it ended up taking a lot of the pressure off of the nurses at bedside to educate. You know, some of our nurses, they have like, you know, three babies on the unit on their caseload. And if they're up on the intermediate unit, you know, let's say they're all early feeders and all the parents are coming in at the feeding time and they all want education. It's really, really stressful for them to sit with each family and provide that education, especially if they all show up at the same time. So again, it wasn't the goal of me doing, I was doing it for the families, but what I found was that they started to take more of a supportive role. Those families were coming to the bedside and saying, oh, am I holding the baby and side lying the right way? Oh, can you make sure I have that slow flow nipple, please? Or, oh, I'm going to pace the baby. Is this how you would do it? Did I pace that right? Yeah. And it allowed the nurses, instead of, again, being primary educator, to be primary supporter, which is so good for those families' confidence and competence. They would say, oh, I love how you're holding that baby and side lying and good job. So it was great for the families. It was great for the nursing load. And I will say in every unit we have them, and God bless them, we need them and we need their innovation. But like sometimes they're naysayers, right? There are people that are not quick to take up culture change. And we're still in this really unique period of neonatal science where the information is coming fast. And what you did 10 years ago is very different from what you did 20 years ago, which is very different from what you did 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. We're growing so much in some of our units. We have older nursing staff that, you know, maybe still feel like they should feed a rock.
That's true.
That maybe still feel like they should encourage the feeding and constantly twist and tap and jiggle the nipple. Mm-hmm. And so what I found was that those nurses were less likely to teach those strategies because they didn't want to be a naysayer to what these families are now educating. So the consistency across feeding recommendations significantly improved.
Yeah.
And it was awesome. So nice. It was really, really nice. So I say, do it. I think it will be a great service for your NICU, for your families, for the babies, and for your entire NICU staff. I actually had a couple of nurses that would come and sit. And like, if they had, like, they took break at 4 o'clock and they would listen and they would learn. And it was just a great way to do it. So yes.
One of the other things that y'all may have already thought about is, we are about to put all of our, we have a work group with nursing to work on getting all of our discharge education into small snippets, like videos, and get them on iPads so that then the parents, while they're sitting there, we can start the discharge education very early on. But we're also talking about putting some of that, what you're talking about, this feeding education before, so that we can also into small videos, so that we can also start allowing those parents to watch these, listen to these, and then it promotes really good discussion with therapy. And so I don't know, that's one thing we're about to try. So, but I love your idea. That's, I love it. So,
all right. I think we have time for maybe one more question. I lie. We should do this.
Yes.
Okay.
You do.
No more questions.
You go.
Although there's one really good question about how to do clinical research, and I really want to answer it, but I don't think I'm going to have time, because the most important thing is that we have two winners for the raffle to present. I think in the chat, you know, Nant has been putting some information about the course, but two people, won the complimentary course.
Yes.
And our winners are
Sharon Warden, I hope I said that correctly, and Ginger Mason.
Congratulations.
So Sharon and Ginger. So Nant will be reaching out to both of you today. Do you want to quickly say something about clinical research?
Yes. There's a really great question here. So what advice can you share for clinicians who want to start exploring clinical questions, collaborate with other providers, and hopefully publish results when our staffing is not designed to take time out of the clinical care for research? Our team has a strong desire to know more and do better in our clinical care, but are struggling to find ways to do all of the things. I love it.
I love this question.
I love it so much. You every day are taking your own questions and you're finding your own answers. Mm-hmm. So all you now need to do is do it in a more standardized way. And in a way that you can then look at it differently. So like a lot of times, like there's this idea of like, oh, doing research is like so big. It's so time consuming. It's so much. The truth is like every day we're answering our own questions. It's just that if we can find a way to create a simple question and for you to collect that data easily during your clinical care and record it easily in your clinical care, it won't feel like you're spending hours a day doing research. Mm-hmm. So the biggest bulk is the beginning of a research study where you have to write all of your protocols and get your IRB approval. But if you write your study in a easy to do way, like my first clinical study was really very, very easy. It was like 5 swallows of cold liquid under fluoroscopy. So it literally mm-hmm. asked for maybe a total of 2 extra minutes in my clinical day. Mm-hmm. That's nothing.
Yeah.
That's nothing. Right. So, take a question, make it an easy question. And then again, the IRB, that's another kit and caboodle.
And I want to make one quick thing after you finish.
But then the actual part of incorporating it into your clinical world, you're already getting so much of this information. Yeah. So you just have to find a way to make it part of your day. And there's ways to do that. I want to present on this.
Yeah. And so I want to end it with this. First of all, this was an absolute honor to be with this amazing, amazing, amazing human and researcher and contributor to our field.
And you.
But also thank you to Nant for yes. inviting us to do this course. We just want to help therapists. We want to help babies. We want to help families. And we want to hear from you. And so this has been an honor and exciting to talk to you. But also about clinical research, that's what I wanted to do. And I partnered with a local university. They helped me with the IRB process. They helped me with, so anyway, this is a good talk.
This is a very good talk.
I'm like,
I don't know if I'll accept it, but I'm going to do it.
Yeah, exactly. So thank you so much for having us today. And Louisa, it's been wonderful being with you.
Thank you, NAMP community, for coming and chatting with us. And we just look forward to seeing you and hearing from you and all the good things that you're going to be doing for your babies and your unit. So keep up the good work. The fact that you took an hour out of your day for your growth, that is to be applauded.
And you are all doing amazing work, and we're all here for each other. We're all here to support each other and hope to see you at NAMP. Come say hi at NAMP.
Yay. Bye, everybody.